HarperCollins and Harper Audio present System Error, Where Big Tech Went Wrong and How We Can Reboot, by Rob Reich, Mehran Sahami, and Jeremy M. Weinstein, read by Kaleo Griffith. Preface. In times of crisis, ordinary citizens, confused and disoriented, settling into paralysis, can come to believe that, as Plato had argued, they are not up to the job of making difficult decisions. In hard times, democratic citizens may become more willing to hand over the business of politics to experts, and to abandon the institutional frameworks, the rights and liberties, that secure their position as participants in the political process. The danger of intellectual paralysis in the face of chaos is finally that it undermines the first premise of democracy, namely, that ordinary citizens will always be ready to think. Danielle Allen, Aims of Education Address, September 20th, 2001. On January 6th, 2021, the U.S. Capitol was stormed by insurrectionists who had been whipped into action at a rally earlier that day featuring President Donald Trump. Their goal was to violently overturn the result of the presidential election, which they had been falsely told for weeks had been stolen. That message had been delivered most prominently by Trump himself, despite more than 60 failed lawsuits challenging election results and thorough refutations by election officials across the country. The big tech platforms had been a key conduit for the accusations of election fraud for months before. On January 6th, they finally woke up to the horror they had enabled. Twitter locked Trump's account, which had nearly 90 million followers, denying him permission to post. 2 days later, citing a risk of further incitement to violence, Twitter permanently banished Trump from the platform, erasing everything on his account in one fell swoop. Similar suspensions took place on Facebook, Instagram, YouTube, and Snapchat. Trump turned to the still active @POTUS Twitter account and posted that he had been silenced, before that tweet was quickly removed by the platform as well. The platform's rebuke of Trump's election disinformation was also an alarm bell about how much power is concentrated in the hands of a few big tech companies. The President of the United States, often touted as the leader of the free world, was unceremoniously stripped of his favorite means of communicating with his tens of millions of followers. Whether that was a necessary step to reduce the possibility of further violence after the election, a long overdue decision by the platforms to take away a megaphone from a man whose history of lies far predated the 2020 election, or the tech elite's blatant censorship of the highest elected official in the United States, it cast an unmistakable light on the extraordinary power that technology, and more significantly, the people who develop it, have over us. Big tech's role in and reaction to the events that led to the storming of the U.S. Capitol only highlight the concerns about technology that have been mounting for years. Seemingly endless reports of privacy breaches and stories of behavior manipulation resulting from vast troves of data mined by large companies have made it commonplace to view big tech through a dark lens. Some argue that the internet, smartphones, and computers have delivered to us a set of devices hell-bent on hijacking our attention and addicting us to the screen, while gathering ever more data of our online behavior. And as borne out at the Capitol, a tidal wave of misinformation and disinformation on social media platforms has served to undermine our trust in science, exacerbate political polarization, and threaten democracy itself. All of this powered by a small number of companies with immense market power and growing political influence. At this same unprecedented time, we experienced the COVID-19 pandemic, which as of this writing has taken more than 3 million lives worldwide while upending work, education, the economy, and our personal lives. The pandemic caused one of those rare moments of instantaneous behavior change with extraordinary long-term implications. Vladimir Lenin is alleged to have said, "There are decades when nothing happens, and then there are weeks where decades happen." Overnight, much of the world shifted to working from home, and schools closed as public health authorities imposed social distancing rules, and in some areas, shelter-in-place orders. Video conferencing soared as air travel ground to a halt. Technologies for file sharing and workplace collaboration enabled many aspects of the economy to proceed apace. People flocked in record numbers to Netflix as a substitute for movie theaters. The use of Facebook and other social media networks skyrocketed as people sought connections to friends and family. Video conferencing enabled children to keep attending school and people to retain a connection to their loved ones when it wasn't possible to be together physically. And tech companies across the board stepped up to foreground authoritative scientific information about the pandemic, develop contact tracing apps to help contain it, and deploy artificial intelligence to hasten the development of medical treatments and potential vaccines, and to power robots to handle tasks such as delivering medication to sick hospital patients. In short, our professional and personal lives, our economy, and intimate relationships, and even our health would have been far worse without the internet and our familiar addictive devices. As we exit the COVID-19 pandemic and enter a new political moment, the window is finally opening for a mature consideration of technology, one that avoids both the techno-boosterism that accompanied its early decades and the tech lash that has followed. Sure, there remain plenty of criticisms to be made of Facebook, the privacy policies of Zoom, the acceleration of automation in an age of smart machines without regard for job displacement, and the toxic misinformation and disinformation flowing through social media platforms. But that just underscores the essential work of our new post-pandemic era. We must strive now to find ways to harness the power of technology to deliver its considerable benefits, while diminishing its equally apparent harms to individuals and societies. We now possess the wisdom to see technological innovation as something other than an external force that works upon us. The path of technological development and the effects of technology on us are things we can shape, things we must shape. When we uncritically celebrate technology or unthinkingly criticize it, the end result is to leave technologists in charge of our future. This book was written to provide an understanding of how we as individuals, and especially together as citizens in a democracy, can exercise our agency, reinvigorate our democracy, and direct the digital revolution to serve our best interests. For the past 20 years, we have been teaching at Stanford University, the seedbed of Silicon Valley. It is a research powerhouse with numerous Nobel laureates, MacArthur Foundation geniuses, and Pulitzer Prize-winning writers to rival the best. But behind the facade of this paradisiacal, self-professed nerd nation, we started to observe some concerning patterns. Innovation and disruption were the buzzwords on campus, and our students broadcasted an almost utopian view that the old ways of doing things were broken and technology was the all-powerful solution. It could end poverty, fix racism, equalize opportunity, strengthen democracy, and even help topple authoritarian regimes. Every year at new student orientation, one of our students told us enthusiastically, we bring in some tech billionaire who was held up as the paragon of what you can achieve, and that's the life you should want. The former president of the university was heard to say that government was incompetent, and the idea of encouraging any student to go into government service in order to make a difference was ridiculous. Perhaps most disconcerting, the enthusiasm for the digital economy and the money-making pipeline from Stanford to Silicon Valley was not tempered by critical reflection on just whose problems were being solved and whose were ignored, who was benefiting from innovation, and who was losing, and who had a voice, and who remained unheard in shaping our technological future. This is not just a Stanford point of view. Many of the same pathologies we've identified are on display on a broader scale. For example, even with the blowback against technologists, uncritical headlines around the globe too often claim that technology will solve our most complex problems, whether climate change, poverty, or mental health crises, a naive optimism we have worked hard to counter in our students. Making the world a better place has become more a punchline than a real mission statement for major technology companies, underscoring the difficulty many of us face in determining what is truly in the public interest. We joined forces to try to bring about a cultural intervention on campus that might reverberate into the tech world and beyond. Our view was simple. We cannot find a path to a better technological future without the three distinct perspectives we bring to the table. Mehran Sahami was recruited to Google in its startup days by Sergey Brin. One of the inventors of email spam filtering technology, Mehran spent a decade in the industry working on applications that are now used by billions of people. In 2007, with a background in machine learning and AI, he returned to Stanford as a computer science professor. He wants technologists to understand that the decisions they make in producing code have real social consequences that affect millions of people. Though engineers may write code with good intentions, Mehran is concerned that, too often, social consequences are not considered until a major screw-up makes the problem transparent for everyone. At that point, it may be too late. Jeremy Weinstein went to Washington with President Barack Obama in 2009. A key staffer in the White House, he foresaw how new technologies might remake the relationship between governments and citizens, and launched Obama's Open Government Partnership, a global network of governments, NGOs, and technologists fighting to ensure that governments deliver for people. He then joined Samantha Power in New York when she was appointed U.S. Ambassador to the United Nations. In the wake of North Korea's cyber attack on Sony and the FBI-Apple encryption fight, they confronted the enormous gulf between those who build technology and those who bear the responsibility for governing a society transformed by technology. But just as policymakers are ignorant of technology in many ways, technologists are naive about, and perhaps even willfully blind to, the importance of public policy and the ways that social science can help us understand, anticipate, and even mitigate the impacts of technology on society. When he returned to Stanford in 2015 as a professor of political science, Jeremy made it his top priority to teach young computer scientists and to bring social science to the study of how technologies are reshaping our social environments. Rob Reich is a philosopher who is a leader of the university's Center for Ethics and Society and Institute for Human-Centered Artificial Intelligence. He brings a Socratic orientation, asking probing and uncomfortable questions designed to shake up the perspective of the technologist. What makes disruption valuable? Why obsess over optimization? Is increasing click-through rates on digital advertisements your highest calling? Perhaps most important, he wants to challenge engineers' perception of their role. It's not enough to be a problem solver without asking deeper questions. Is this a problem worth solving? Are there particular ways we should solve it, given the things we value? Given the power of technology, who deserves a seat at the table in defining the problems and seeking solutions? Where does democracy fit in, if at all? We brought our collective expertise together and designed a new course on the ethics and politics of technological change that quickly became one of the most popular classes on campus. While our three perspectives, the technologist, the policymaker, and the philosopher, are central to the course, we recognized that other voices were also essential. In our teaching, we sought to incorporate perspectives on technology that go beyond our own. Communities of color that are disproportionately harmed by particular innovations, those whose livelihoods might be threatened by automation. Women shining a light on the sexist culture.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.